Welcome to Movie Life Crisis. Join us as we watch the best movies from 30 years ago.
Recently, two high school students unearthed a prehistoric man in their own backyard. Their story is completely true. Encino Man.
Flamage. Oh, he is so greasy.
Oh, wow. The cheese is old and moldy.
El queso es viejo y petrido. Encino Man, Movie Life Crisis, Season 2, Episode 11. Brendan Fraser, Rudy.
That's awesome.
Pauly Shore, Encino Man.
Rudy.
Rudy Rudiger, little Rudiger. His name's not Rudiger.
His name's not important.
Dude, there's even in the 5 seconds of Pauly Shore in that trailer, I just go, why? What? How did Pauly Shore happen?
Dude, I kept thinking like, oh, maybe he's good at stand-up.
Yeah.
I don't think that's it. I think his family was in the business or something, maybe.
His family was in the business. But dude, I mean, we'll get into it as we talk about this movie. Pauly Shore was like a pretty big pop culture figure in the 1990s. Like,
are
had
you
a
kidding?
TV show, was yes. an MTV VJ, had a bunch of movies.
He was on a Goofy movie. Like, dude, he was...
This is the first Pauly Shore movie. This is his first movie role. And then he does a bunch of other movies after this one.
Boy, does he.
I don't know that we're going to cover all of those on the podcast. Maybe we will.
Are you saying there's no son-in-law, no biodome, no in the army now?
No in the army now. In the army now, I would do.
No jury biodome, duty?
Jury duty, biodome, son-in-law. Well, we'll see what the calendar looks like. I wouldn't be upset if we missed those.
The dad from son-in-law is that guy.
All right, cool. Movie Life Crisis, Season 2, Episode 11. I don't know how we made it to 11 already, but we're here.
This is cool. It's flying.
It's flying. I'm JT here with Jeff. Why was this movie chosen? I like this movie. Brendan Fraser.
Who really doesn't love Brendan Fraser?
Brendan Fraser should have like 100% approval rating. He is the best. I kind of forgot Pauly Shore was in this, honest to God, until
what?
I started prepping. Like, I was like, oh yeah, Encino Man, Brendan Fraser.
How can you forget Pauly Shore? The whole time I was just like, who's this guy in the 70s outfits? Like... talking in words I don't understand.
When he came on screen for the first scene, I wrote in my notes that, like, he's dressed like Cyndi Lauper if she was in Jefferson Airplane. Like, freaking bell bottoms and, like vests,
oh.
Pink tie-dye, like, mesh shirts. His hair is all freaking froey and stupid.
I don't know. So, if you say, like, hey, Mr. Horn students, let's watch Encino Man. This is how people used to talk back then. And then Pauly Shore shows up and starts saying all this stuff like about nugs and wheezing juice and grindage.
I didn't know what any of that shit meant.
No, I really did.
I was alive when this movie came out. I didn't know what the hell he was talking about.
I still don't.
Yeah. Did you like this movie when it came out?
Yeah, I loved it.
All right.
I thought it was cool. It's one of those it's silly and fun, and that's why I liked it.
Yeah, I liked it too. I didn't see it like a million times, but I know I saw it a half dozen times.
Oh, yeah.
It wasn't like in heavy rotation, but I have seen it a handful of times.
I really liked Sean Astin ever since Goonies, and then so anything he was in, I was all about.
He had a really solid career, which is still going. But
yeah.
All right, well, sweet. Let's do Name That Tune. I got you this week. I feel good about it.
Oh, Jesus. Why do I always forget about it? Oh, man. All right, so don't play it. I got this.
All right.
For some reason, I want to say it's some sort of Teddy Riley. Is it Guy Rump Shaker? I don't know what it is. What is it?
It is Back to the Hotel from the group N Too Deep.
Nothing.
It's just got that one really hooky like background part. The whole rest of it, I was like, what the
hell? Hang on one second.
In Too Deep, Back to the Hotel.
Never would have got it.
number 78 on the year. This is like a two-person rap group.
Nice.
This is by far their biggest hit.
Never heard of it.
Same. But I did recognize that intro that they sampled, that horn part. That song, by the way, 52 million views on that on your YouTube.
That's a lot, right?
Yeah, that's a whole lot. So even though me and you have not heard of it, people have.
Swing and a miss. Damn it.
Encino Man.
Wait. What was the name of the band again?
N Too Deep. The letter N, the number 2, and the word deep.
Cool.
It's terrible. Yeah. All right. Synopsis.
Quick synopsis. When they find a frozen caveman in their backyard, two high school outcasts thaw him and introduce him to modern life, while he in turn gets them to actually enjoy life.
Sean Astin and Pauly Shore are the high school kind of best friends slash losers, and they're trying to... Sean Astin, in particular, is on a quest to become popular. Rudy's like, I'm tired of people not inviting me to shit.
Yeah.
And his solution to not being popular, I swear to God, even though Brendan Fraser is a caveman who is frozen and then comes back to life, the most unrealistic part of the movie is that Sean Astin's plan to be popular is he's going to hand dig a pool in his backyard and then have a party there.
Hand dig a pool with a shovel, like...
With a shovel.
Regular old spaded shovel.
A wheelbarrow, yes. The caveman coming out of suspended animation was more realistic than that plan to be popular.
It was not a good plan. And also that pool scene at the end when they're all swimming in it.
Yeah.
That's gross.
Yeah, because it's just a pond. He didn't put any concrete down. He just had a big pit and he filled it up with water. That's not a pool.
Yeah, it's a good call.
$7 million budget. This movie grossed $41 million. It did like $9 million on the opening weekend, so it made its budget back on its release weekend, which is great.
Yeah, it's really good. By the way, did you know that they couldn't get the ice cube right? Okay, so the ice cube that Link, Brendan Fraser, is actually stuck in the beginning. They had like a fake Brendan Fraser in there, like a body double, and they couldn't get the ice to be clear enough. So they were trying all these different things. And when they finally figured out how to keep the ice completely clear for the 30 seconds it was going to be on screen, it cost $50,000. So of the $7 million.
$7 million.
$50,000 of it was just a 30-second ice cube.
Yeah, I wonder how much was the one car scene where he drove on two wheels for like 2 minutes. I feel like that was a big chunk of the budget as well.
Yeah, especially since the guy who was driving it didn't look anything like Brendan Fraser.
Oh, man, you mean to tell me that Brendan Fraser can't drive a car on two wheels for like 6 miles?
No, what I'm saying is they couldn't find anybody that looked enough like Brendan Fraser that could drive a car because it was a chubby white dude. And I was like, that's definitely not Brendan Fraser.
The awards? I didn't see any awards. You found any awards?
No awards for this.
Pauly Shore does collect a string of raspberries later on in his career, but he's not gotten one yet.
Not for this.
Sequel spinoffs. I think they made an Encino Woman. I don't know if it was a movie or a TV show.
That was a TV movie. Yeah, sequel.
Yeah.
And there was a book called Stoney's Encino High Notebook.
Yeah, I saw that.
Yeah, so they made a book about it too, because, you know, you need somebody writing in Stoney's words.
Stoney is the Pauly Shore character. Dude, this movie is prime for a reboot. Someone's got to be trying to set this up again, I feel sure.
Really?
Yeah, because it's just a simple concept, but like, it's not well remembered enough that anyone would be mad that you tried to bring it back. Dude, they're rebooting Under Siege. How could they not be trying to reboot Encino Man?
Jesus, I guess.
Do you remember when you saw this movie? Do you have any memories of like early viewings?
I'm like 99% sure this was one we watched at a Will birthday party.
Yeah.
I used to get Pauly Shore movies confused, like Biodome and Son-in-Law and Army Now and all that. One of those we saw on a Will birthday party at the Hammond Theater in the mall across from Cuco's. But like, I want to say it's in the Army Now.
I feel like it was in the Army Now also. I
feel like it was David Alan Grier was in it. And
yeah.
Is he in that one? I don't know.
I'll tell you in 1996 when we do it.
I feel like that's what it actually was. But I do remember watching this a few times. I just don't, not the first time, I don't remember.
I don't either. I feel like I must have seen it on TV, because I feel like it was on TV a lot.
Yeah, I could see that.
But I don't have any specific memories of this one, just like, I'd seen it a bunch, because as we were watching, I was like, oh, I remember that part. I would not have, but now I do.
Yeah, it was definitely coming back to me. When they went into that bar, I was like, whoa, all this I remember now. All of a sudden, it all comes back to me.
Yeah, the most stereotypical Mexican bar that you could possibly imagine.
I don't know. The one on Trojan War was pretty stereotypical. Remember that one? Where she thought he was David Hasselhoff?
Oh, man.
I want a prophylactic.
Where do you rank this one? How many chimney dogs?
All right, so it's a silly comedy. It looks like it was filmed really fast and cheaply. I gave it 5. I liked it a lot more when I was younger, but it was still okay.
I gave it a 6.5.
Wow.
There's nothing great about it. It's completely forgettable, but I also really enjoyed it while I was watching it.
Yeah, yeah.
So like once it was done, I was like, there's so many stupid things about this movie, but it's also, you know, it's going to be stupid. So it's like, you don't even really need to nitpick it. Like it holds together. Yeah. And I thought all the major performances were really good, except for Pauly Shore, who I don't understand. But he's doing exactly what you want him doing. I just don't like it.
What is that? Like, what is that?
I don't know.
Is that like Larry the Cable Guy talking like that?
I don't know. I was the exact right age to think Pauly Shore's hilarious, and I never did, and I still don't.
I don't get it, dude. I want to get it, though.
Dude, even the quote that I got of him, it's just like, this is how this dude talked. Yeah. All the time, and they kept giving him shows and movies.
It's probably the same one that I got.
I'm sure it is. Well, like Tom Green is kind of similar. Like he was so weird, but Tom Green, I actually thought at sometimes, especially in movies, could be really funny.
Yeah,
like he was doing a very particular Tom Green shtick.
Yeah, I didn't like his
shtick. I don't know if he wasn't as famous as Pauly Shore, and so I didn't get as tired of him or what.
There are things that. I don't know. Is he just a stoner kid? Is that like, I mean, you know what I'm saying? Like, I don't know.
Dude, I don't know. If you're asking me to explain Pauly Shore, I don't.
Yeah, I'm saying like, we didn't have any friends that talk like this.
No.
Like, I can't think of any. I don't know.
No, and we're in junior high when this movie comes out. So like, that's the exact demo that he's going for. Right. Like preteen boys. And none of us were like, yeah, Pauly Shore, high five. Let's go.
I didn't even chuckle when he was saying the stuff. I was just like, what? I don't get it. Like, wheezing the juice. We used to say that stuff, like we used to say it on the way home from practice.
From swim team practice. No, Wheezing the Juice is iconic, but the way Pauly Shore says it makes me want to punch him in his freaking Janis Joplin looking face.
He looks exactly the same, just older. It's weird.
I know. And he's like, it just kind of, where he's the chit is.
Yeah.
Buddy. It's like, dude, what the fuck? Why are you talking like that?
And he keeps doing the thing where he's like over his shoulder, wiggling his fingers, trying to get somebody to follow him.
Jazz fingers and making like gross, like suctioning noises.
That's because he's the weasel.
He's the weasel. I don't understand it. Maybe we'll do all the Pauly Shore movies to try and figure out why Pauly Shore.
That sounds like a great idea. We should do every single one.
Yeah. So you got it 5 out of 10. I got it 6.5 out of 10. Just, this is an enjoyable movie. And dude, here's the other thing. 90 minutes in and out.
It was way quicker than I thought too.
This thing is tight. I blasted right through it. I looked up because I was taking notes on my phone and I was also casting from my phone to the TV and I was like, shit, there's only 20 minutes of this thing left. I was like, man, we're almost done.
That's awesome.
I was like, I got to find some good scenes.
That's the problem. Picking through all the awesome scenes to find the three that you like the most.
Yes, sifting through. Speaking of, let's get into the best.
Sure.
You want to start with scenes?
Yeah, you want to go first?
Yeah, the first one I had is when Brendan Fraser's unfrozen and then he's going to stay at Rudy's house as an exchange student from Estonia. And then they're all having dinner. So Pauly Shore's there, Rudy's there, Brendan Fraser's there, his parents are there, his sister's there. And Brendan Fraser like catches a housefly out of the air and then he eats it.
Yeah.
He doesn't like the food that they're serving, but he gets down on the ground. He's eating out of the dog bowl while the dog is eating.
Yeah.
Pauly Shore's like making inappropriate comments about the like preteen sister, like telling the dad like, hey, I was just thinking, Mr. Martin, like I could marry your daughter and we could be related. And I was like, that is fucked up.
Yeah.
And not funny.
Yeah.
And I'm surprised that dad didn't like give you the elbow right then.
I like that dad. He's the dad from License to Drive.
Yes, he is.
Yeah, I also had that. I had the whole scene where he's like thawing out and doing the whole thing. And when they're trying to like, you know, Rudy's trying to get Janis Joplin to go with him on this and say like, hey, it's going to work out. We're going to be super popular. That's all we got to do. Something like, I don't, first of all, he said, dude, we have the missing link here. That's not the missing link.
No, Cro-Magnon Man is not the missing link.
Yeah. Second of all, they don't call him Cro-Magnon anymore.
No, they don't.
Anatomically early humans is right. Modern early humans is right. They don't say Cro-Magnon because it's just not specific enough.
Dude, 1992 Brendan Fraser is not one of our ancient ancestors. That guy's like better looking and in better shape than we are now. Like that, Maybe one day we'll evolve into that. That's not way back up the chain.
Right, I know, but that's what they were selling. And because, I don't know, I teach some of this, I'm just like, what the heck? Why is he enthralled by fire? He's not an early hominid that would have, he would have definitely had fire. Like, what are we doing? I liked it for what it was, but the whole time I was just like, what the, why are they doing that? Like, they filled the bathtub up to give him a bath. And it filled all the way to the tippity top. And every time he moved, it sloshed over the side. And I was like, what are we doing?
And they put in all of the cleaning products for the entire bathroom. They just had, like, in two hands, were each just squirting freaking shampoo and conditioner and mouthwash. Body wash and soap and mouthwash and bath bombs. And he was freaking splashing around while Right Said Fred played I'm Too Sexy. And,
yes.
The soundtrack was phenomenal, by the way. PM Dawn was in the beginning. Right Said Fred. There's a bunch of jams.
So when I heard Reality Used to Be a Friend of Mine,
yeah,
I was like, oh, snap, that's from the PM Dawn song that I used to like. You know, there's two of them.
Right. One, all both of them.
All both of them. But I didn't think that was actually PM Dawn singing that in the beginning.
It might not have been.
Oh, but that's what you heard too?
I did. And I just assumed it was. Yeah. I just assumed it was PM Dawn.
Yeah. Yeah.
We could probably find that out, but I couldn't when I was doing the research.
No, I didn't even look it up, but I remember hearing it.
But yeah, no, that dinner scene, it was one of the only times I laughed. Thought there was a lot of fun stuff happening. So that had that one on the list. What's your first one?
My first one is that I wrote down is the prom scene.
Oh yeah.
First of all, where are all the teachers? Was there nobody? Like, I just like stopped the fight. Nobody was there. Like, chaperoning anything. Like, a dude gets thrown into the cake and then the prom just keeps going. They just start, the band starts it back up again, and then they all have like a group dance that they do, and the band was singing like not heavy metal but hard rock. I was like, what?
I just had a flashback to Hook when freaking Robin Williams meets the Lost Boys. He's like, where are your parents?
Yes, exactly.
You have a severe caca mouth.
Dude, they freaking ruined the cake, but then they went back right into it, and they just, everybody had a group dance, and they all started doing the same thing.
That's such a, that's the reason why I had that scene down, is because, like, in every high school movie, I think, was Footloose the first time that ever happened?
Probably.
I think it was Footloose. But anyway, like, Brendan Fraser, like, makes up a dance, and then everyone learns the dance, and they're all doing the dance together. It's like, every freaking high school movie has to have that moment.
And even Rudy. Rudy turns to, what's her name, the PCU chick. And
yeah, he's Katie, like, from PCU.
Yeah, he's like, watch this. And then he starts doing the same dance, and it's a lot of, like, kicking your leg up in the air.
Oh, my God.
Just that whole thing, well, I liked it, but I was also mad about it.
Yeah, I had that scene down too, just because it's such a freaking trope to have all the high school kids. Somebody makes up a dance and everyone learns it, and we're all doing it together as the camera pans away. And right. That's how the scene ends.
Plus, that was probably my favorite time that Matt ever said, shush! So I put that down because that was one of my favorite. I can remember saying that after this movie came out.
The boyfriend, the D-bag.
Yeah,
he was like trying to blow everything up, the main antagonist.
And that guy was in Wayne's World. We already saw him. He was the guy in the middle of the back seat almost trying to throw up.
Oh, really? Michael DeLuise?
I'm pretty sure he's in Wayne's World.
Nice. I didn't realize that.
I think he has longer hair.
Yeah, I had that scene as well. What's your next scene?
My next one is the driver's ed scene when he drives Same. On two wheels.
Same.
The only other time I've ever seen that, though, is when Arnold Schwarzenegger does it in Twins. I don't even remember ever seeing that ever.
The driving on two wheels thing?
Yeah, for a long period of time.
For a long period of time. Yeah, Brendan Fraser's character, like, loves video games. He especially likes these, like, car racing games. So he sees a driver's ed car. He gets super excited. He, like, dives into it.
Yeah.
Takes off. Freaking Rudy and Great Value Janis Joplin jump in there with him. Katie from PCU is already in the passenger seat. He takes it up on two wheels and he drives like all the way through the town.
All the way through.
And then he eventually just sets the car down in front of this Mexican bar, and they go into this Mexican bar. And I had those two, just more than one scene. I had those two on mine as well. Driving scene into the like Mexican bar.
Let me ask you this. There's a guy in the Mexican bar that was towards the end. He was the bartender, and he's the guy who yells cops. And he's just got this really unique facial hair and dreads. And I don't know what else he was from. And I couldn't find him on the thing because there was no picture of him on IMDb. And I don't know his name.
I don't know. I didn't get that guy.
You didn't see him?
Look him up.
Dang it. I thought for sure you would have saw that guy. Oh, my goodness. I found him.
Yeah. Who is he?
He is Jeffrey Anderson Gunter. He's known for Encino Man and March for Death with Steven Seagal.
Nice.
Oh, man. Yeah, you would know.
Yes, I know exactly who you're talking about.
Yeah. As soon as I saw that guy, I was like, what the? I know that guy, but I didn't know what I knew him from. He was in the black or white video.
He was in the black or white video
where they're morphing the faces. That's where I saw him. Holy crap. That's weird.
He was in Naked Gun 33 and a third. Only the Strong. Oh, Only the Strong. Oh, I remember that movie. God, I freaking love that movie. Such a stupid karate movie. There's no way we're doing that.
Only the Strong. That's got the guy from Iron Chef, doesn't it? It is the guy from Iron Chef.
Yeah.
Dude, wait. For reals, the fact that when I saw that it was black or white, I can vividly picture him like looking to the side, then looking at the camera, and his face morphs into an Asian woman.
Yeah, and he's got the dreadlocks.
That's so weird.
Yeah, and he's an Arrow. He's an American Dad. He's in Naked Gun 33 and a third.
Nice.
Yeah, that guy should have been credited in this movie.
Yeah,
I guess maybe he didn't have any lines other than that, like one cops.
Yeah, it's like cops. That's all he said. He was like cleaning a cup, didn't even yell it.
Nice. Did you have another scene? That's my three.
Yeah, I just had the prom scene, the opening scene, and the driver scene. I put the pool scene at the end, but I just wanted to mention how gross it was that they were all swimming in murky, muddy water.
In the pond water.
In the pond.
That Rudy hand dug because he was trying to be popular.
Freaking Rudy. Come on, man.
High school sucks. I want to be popular. I'm going to dig a big hole. That's my plan.
Yeah. Doesn't he know that he's going to get so much more popular when he goes to Notre Dame and walks on as on the football team?
Yeah, when he walks onto the football team at Notre Dame, he's going to freaking blow up. Yeah. And then he's going to, like, take a journey to Middle Earth.
Yeah.
Like, he's going to be super popular.
Plus, when he's in college, he befriends Mikey from Swingers.
Yeah.
Speaking of Swingers, Sue from,
yeah,
from
Sue.
Swinger. He's in there. You saw him?
Yeah, Sue is part of the gang. I got him in my cameos.
Yeah, I did too.
Cameos list. Patrick Van Horn.
Yeah, Patrick Van Horn. That's right.
All right. Quotes. My first quote, we already said, the cheese is old and moldy. El queso es viejo y podrido.
Yeah. Cheese is old and moldy is one of mine. There was a toss up between shush and wheeze in the juice. So I just put them both.
Yeah, yeah. I got wheeze in the juice. I'm gonna play the clip for that.
What are you doing, Mrs. Stoney? No, you can't do this. You can't do this here.
Now, please.
Look, Kashmir Rajneesh, why don't you just chill?
No, but still.
Link and I are cruising the mountain, bro, and we figure we's a little juice.
No, wheezing the juice.
Wheeze the juice.
No, wheezing the juice.
Oh, my God.
He's so stupid. Why does he talk like that?
I don't know.
They hate it.
They loved it.
They freaking loved it. Dude, he made millions and millions of dollars just talking like an idiot and making weird sounds with his mouth.
He probably has tons of that left.
Well, his parents were rich. He was fine.
He probably spent it all on mesh shirts and jean jackets.
And perms.
I think that's natural, actually.
I had the cheese is old and moldy and wheezing the juice. I didn't have a third one.
All right, so I did have a third one that I wrote down.
All right.
And I'm going to try to read it like Pauly Shore would, if you'd like.
Oh, shit. All right, go ahead.
All right, hold on. I got to lock it in. I can't. I'm just going to read it in a straight voice because I'm not going to be able to do it. If you're edged because I'm wheezing all your grindage, just chill. Because if I had the whole Brady Bunch thing happening at my pad, I'd go grind over there. So don't tax my gig so hard.
I remember when he said that because I was like, what the fuck is he? I didn't understand. I had in my notes because Link is a caveman. Brendan Fraser is a caveman. So one of the things they're doing is teaching him English. Pauly Shore is teaching him English. And in my notes, I wrote down, is there anyone less qualified to teach someone how to speak English than Pauly Shore in this movie? None of the shit that he's saying makes any sense.
Yeah, agreed. I don't get the shtick. I want to get it.
Dude, good for him, man. I'm happy that he made a bunch of money. And if he wants to keep making movies, that's fine. I'm not upset about it. If I see Pauly Shore, I'm not mad at him. I think it's awesome. I just don't understand why people liked it.
Yeah. Like every time something would happen to his ears, he would be like, watch the lobes. I was like, what? Why does he keep saying that? He said it like four times.
Okay. Characters, what's your first character?
First character I had was Michael DeLuise, Matt, the bully.
Michael DeLuise.
The way he would like crack his knuckles and the shush. And he was just, he was a jerk. I liked it. He played it perfect.
He was a really good jerk. And I liked that, like, Sean Astin is really short. Sean Astin's 5'7", Pauly Shore's 5'7". So Michael DeLuise is 5'8", because they have to shoot a bunch of close-ups of him, like, nose to nose.
Yeah.
Brendan Fraser's, like, 6'3". So, like, when Brendan Fraser is tangling with Michael DeLuise, they have to shoot it very carefully because Brendan Fraser towers over him.
Way over, yeah.
That's one of the things in movies that I'm always really interested in. Like, oh, Tom Cruise is a tough guy, except he's really 5'4", so how many boxes is he going to stand on in this movie? I like to figure that out. It's like, oh, if you're an actress who's like 5'5", you can't act next to Tom Cruise because his lifts don't make him tall enough.
Right, right.
Like, I'm interested in that sort of thing, so I liked that the bully was like 5'8".
Yeah. By the way, I did figure out what part he was. He was the guy with the long hair in Wayne's World that said he liked the producer's wife or something.
Oh, the camera guy.
Yeah, the camera guy that was like counting down.
Yeah.
Doing three. The thing. Yeah. Yes. That. So that's what he was on there.
Nice.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Yeah, I liked him. He did a good job. I didn't have him. The first one I have is the teacher, who is Gus from Groundhog's Day.
Who else could go for some flapjacks?
If we wanted to hit mailboxes, we would have let Ralph drive.
Yeah.
His name is Rick Ducommun.
Yeah.
He's been in a ton of stuff. He's in Spaceballs, Die Hard, Groundhog Day, Last Action Hero.
He's great.
Phenomenal. And he didn't do that much in this movie, but I just was so happy to see him. I had to put him in there.
Yeah, dude, he was the teacher. I threw him in the cameos.
Yeah, he could have been a cameo for me, too. I also want to mention he died in 2015 at the age of 62.
Jeez.
From complications associated with diabetes.
Full-blown diabetes. Full-blown
diabetes.
Oh, man. We're Wilford Brimley when you need him. Cool. I like that guy. My next dude is Brendan Fraser.
Yeah, he's mine as well.
I freaking love that dude.
Everyone loves Brendan Fraser.
I know they do, and that's what I'm...
And they should, because he's the freaking best.
I know some stuff went down, and he got, like, sexually assaulted or something, and then he spoke out about it, and then they blacklisted him, and he didn't get a bunch of things, and he was worried about being perfectly fit like he was in George of the Jungle. But, dude, like, with honors, this movie, Bedazzled, like, all of Bedazzled. Those movies, like, Bedazzled really made me fall in love with him.
Dude, Blast from the Past?
Yeah. Oh, my stars, it's a Negro.
I love Brendan Fraser. He's so good. Yeah, and, like, all that stuff, the sexual assault, getting blacklisted, like, having mental health struggles, feeling like he has to have a six-pack to get work. Dude, he was on Scrubs. He had an amazing guest arc on Scrubs.
Yeah, it was.
He also was the guy who, like, got divorced and was paying his wife $900,000 a year in alimony in a period when he wasn't really doing any movies, and he had to, like, go to the judge and go, like, hey, I don't have it.
Yeah.
Like, that's the, like, if you look up Brendan Fraser news, like, that's one of the, like, top articles, which is a bummer because he's so freaking good.
I put him down because he really did. Like, he was dressed like an asshat, but throughout this whole movie, but I liked him. He did a really great job.
He was so good, man. He's 23. This is his first movie role. He's going to do School Ties later on this year, which we're definitely doing on the podcast.
Heck yeah.
But yeah, he's just, dude, he's really likable. He's like, he's really physical in this role, and it's funny.
I didn't know he could do backflips. Why was he doing backflips?
Just to prove how much more athletic the Cro-Magnon people were than we were. I don't know. Yeah, he was like a freaking acrobat. I don't know.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Like, obviously this movie is stupid, and you know he's not really a caveman, but like, he went for it. He was freaking climbing around on his knuckles when he first got out of the ice.
Yeah.
Like, climbing up on a dirt pile to, like, look out over the world. Yeah, he would get spooked by stuff, and he would run into the corner and, like, curl up in a ball. He just was, like, he was really physical. He was really good. He was really funny. Yeah, he's just great.
I liked his hair. His hair killed it.
Yeah, he had dreadlocks. It looked like he was a poodle with rickets. Like Chris Kirkpatrick from NSYNC back in the day.
Oh, man. That's who I had.
Who's your last one?
My last one is Pauly Shore. The weasel.
The weasel.
Because I didn't understand any of the terminology, and I just...
None of his dialogue made any sense.
None of it. And I was just like, cool. I like it because I'm supposed to, I think.
Dude, read the line again that you had that you wrote down. I want to hear it one more time. Yes.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Do you want me to try to do the voice or just read it straight again?
No, just read it. I just want to remember it. I want to see if I can remember it.
You're not gonna.
I know.
If you're edged because I'm wheezing all your grindage, just chill. Because if I had the whole Brady Bunch thing happening at my pad, I'd go grind over there. So don't tax my gig so hard, core cruster. What an idiot.
Oh, my God. What the? I'm so confused.
I really, dude, I'm totally with you. I don't understand.
That's a totally valid pick. I hated him, but he was Pauly Shore doing Pauly Shore stuff. He was supposed, this is a Pauly Shore movie. This is exactly what you want from him. And he did it.
Yeah.
I just don't understand it. So I didn't have him on my list, but I can't knock it.
Yeah, yeah. But dude, I just something said I need to put him on there.
That's fine.
I almost didn't put the bully. But then when he climbed, I forgot to mention this, when he climbs into Sean Astin's room and gets his foot caught on the hammock.
He gets caught in the hammock.
And he freaking spins around and then slams on the ground really hard. I think that was really him. That was really good stunt work.
Yeah, I think it might have been. Shout out, because that's rough. That's the kind of stuff you don't do after you're like 25.
Yeah.
My third one was the love interest, Megan Ward.
Yeah.
Who, as we've mentioned, played Katie in PCU, which is coming up in 1994. Super excited.
Can't wait.
She's really good. She was really good in this movie. She's really good in PCU. She's really natural. Like, you could see that why, like, all the guys are into her, but like, she's kind of funny. Like, she's a good actress.
Yeah, she definitely did it for me back in the day.
Yeah, I didn't even know what her name was, but I was like, ah, she's great. She's freaking super cute. She's really believable. She's really natural.
Right.
She did a ton of TV after those movies, and then she did like 4 seasons on General Hospital.
Nice.
So, I mean, she's done a lot of work.
Yeah.
But yeah, this movie in PCU in particular, like, she's like, oh yeah, that's the chick. She's freaking good.
Yeah, those are the ones that stood out for me. I definitely recognize her as that. You got any more great characters?
I don't. I have some bonus good that I dug up. Yeah. So, like, Sean Astin, Pauly Shore, and the bully, Michael DeLuise. I already talked about their heights. Like, Sean Astin, Pauly Shore, both 5'7". Michael DeLuise, 5'8". Brendan Fraser, like, 6'2", 6'3". He's freaking ginormous.
Right.
All three of those guys, in addition to being pocket-sized, all have famous parents.
What? That's cool.
Sean Astin, you know who his mom is?
No idea.
Patty Dukes.
What? Sweet!
Yeah, Patty Dukes. And when she got pregnant with him, she wasn't married. She was like in between boyfriends, and one of the boyfriends was Desi Arnaz, and he like offered to sign the birth certificate because they didn't know who, they weren't sure their paternity.
Right.
So he almost had Desi Arnaz as his, you know, official like birth dad.
That would have been awesome.
That would have been awesome. But yeah, but Patty Dukes is his mom. Pauly Shore's mom was Mitzi Shore, who ran the Comedy Store in LA for like her whole life. So she was a rich and famous LA person as well.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's, I remember that now. Yes.
And that's why he was doing stand-up at 17. He grew up in a comedy. His mom owned right. the most famous comedy club on the West Coast.
Yeah.
And that's why at like 22, he's got this movie and he's already been on MTV and he's had a show and he was a stand-up. I don't know why he made these stupid characters and talked like an idiot, but that's what he did, and that's what made him a bunch of money.
Yeah, dude, that's it totally worked for him, though.
It absolutely worked. Good for him. Michael DeLuise is the easiest one to figure out. You know who his parents are?
I'm guessing Dom DeLuise. I have no idea.
Dom DeLuise. Yeah, he's Dom DeLuise's son.
That's crazy.
So all three of those tiny actors have famous parents.
That's good stuff. When I saw DeLuise, yeah. I thought that, but I never thought to follow it down the rabbit hole.
And I thought that they were maybe, I thought Pauly Shore in particular was too old to play high school, but he was like 22. I mean, so obviously too old, but no high school aged person is ever in a movie playing a high school person.
Right.
Like Gabrielle Carter in 90210 was like 38 playing a high school student.
Yes. Yeah, dude.
Sean Astin was 21. Pauly Shore was 22. Brendan Fraser, I think, was 23, something like that.
Nice. Yeah, that's
No, Pauly Shore was 24, but still, like, in the range.
Yeah, he's right in that. He's right in that spot.
The director was Les Mayfield. He was like, had been like a documentary and commercial guy, and he directed this movie. And then he didn't have like a huge directing career, but he did have a very notable directing credit, which you probably saw.
Blue Streak.
1999, Blue Streak.
You just told those guys you have a large cat in your pants.
He just kept saying, I got this, and believe that.
Believe that. Sometimes you gotta feed some speed to your ride, Chief.
Dude, I wish 1999 movies were not so far away, because I just freaking love that movie.
You just watch it 40 times before it gets here.
But yeah, Blue Streak. Monster credit for this guy that no one likes but me and you, but you and
it's, I was going to say, it's just me, you, and the people that laugh at the times that I quote it.
Dude, there's some other people in there. Me and Kyle have been saying since college, like, that he said I was ugly and I couldn't read good.
That's Chappelle, isn't it?
And Dave Chappelle, man. Yeah. Yeah.
He didn't do anything else. Flubber, Miracle on 34th Street. Those are the other two I wrote down, but I didn't like either of those, really.
me neither. The only other thing that I wrote down for good was that Brendan Fraser, at one point when he first was like frozen, he was like watching TV on like an old school console TV, like flipping channels.
Yeah.
And he flipped onto a music video and it was just like this like rock band playing. And at the end of it, like it showed like all the music videos used to show like the artist and the track and then the record and then also the record label. And I saw that the record label was Hollywood Records and the studio that put out this movie was Hollywood Studios.
Nice.
So at this point in time, they were the same.
Sacred Right was the name of the band.
Nice.
I wrote that down because I was like, is that a real band? I got to look that up.
And then Hollywood, I think, got bought pretty soon after this by Disney, or maybe it had already been bought.
No, it was already bought. Yeah, this was a Disney movie. It's on Disney Plus, by the way.
Dude, I freaking tried to look that up and couldn't find it. Do you have any other best?
I don't. I wrote down who the writers were, but they didn't do anything else of note for me.
No, they didn't. The only other thing that I wrote down is when Brendan Fraser also is first unfrozen and he walks into the backyard, he steps on a rake and it hits him right in the face. Anytime I see that, it just always reminds me of The Simpsons.
Always.
Sideshow Bob.
Dude, so that we had a rake in the yard, those kind of rakes. And I just stepped on it to bring it up. And Jake, that was the first thing he said. It was like, Sideshow Bob. I was like, oh man, I think I broke my kid.
Dude, that's amazing. That's freaking A+ parenting.
Yeah, he knew it right away.
Yeah, the parenting podcast after the music podcast, we'll curate a list of Simpsons episodes that all your kids should watch.
Yeah, right.
I'm on to the worst.
I have a couple of worst. We kind of went over a lot of it though.
We did. Okay, the first one I got is hand digging a pool. That's a terrible idea. Horrible. No, thank you.
Horrible idea. So one of the things that I wrote down, I didn't have like worst scenes or characters or anything like that. I just didn't. There was a whole bunch of stuff that they were saying that I didn't understand. At one part, she says it's totally rude.
Yeah.
Sweet. That sounds like it's a bad thing, but in using context clues, I think it was supposed to be a good thing. And like, I think he's jive. Hey, stewardess, I speak jive. Like, I didn't know any of the stuff. Not even talking about like the freaking thing that I read from Pauly Shore. I'm talking about straight up just regular.
The normal people.
Right.
I think the West Coast slang just didn't make it to Louisiana because I didn't know what any of that stuff meant. Because this is like around the time that Beverly Hills 90210, I think, is about to start.
Yeah.
And I think at that point, we could start to like, no matter where you are in the world, you know what kids in California in high school are talking like, because there's about to be a bunch of TV shows that everyone watches.
Right.
But I didn't know what any of this was.
I really didn't know.
Because like in a couple of years when people say like people in Hammond like aren't saying like, yeah, rad. But I knew what it meant because I saw a bunch of movies where people said stuff like that. But yeah. The stuff they said in this movie, I didn't know what any of it meant.
I was really lost. Not lost like I didn't know what was going on, but the whole time I was just like, oh man, I don't remember ever saying that. But the harder I think, I don't think we ever did say that.
Which like how would Brendan Fraser have figured it out if we were alive and speak English natively and don't know what they're saying? And Brendan Fraser's in the freaking convenience store talking about wheezing the juice.
Wheezing the juice.
Yeah, I talked about Pauly Shore, great value Janis Joplin. He dresses like such an idiot. And of course, the costume designer for this movie just said, like, I just let them wear their normal clothes. Like, Pauly Shore wore his normal clothes. Sean Astin just wore, like, jean shorts and t-shirts. And then Brendan Fraser, I just threw, like, baggy clothes on him, old sneakers and, like, baggy shorts.
Right. The other thing, the other few things that I put down is there were some hip-hop dancers. One guy had his hat on backwards. He was a white guy. Yep. And there was a
crisscross.
There was a tag hanging from it. And then the other guy had like a tiny little hat.
Well, the other guy had the overalls, but where there's not pants, there's shorts.
Right.
And he had like the one.
One was
the
off.
One strap undone.
If you notice, they were dancing outside of their locker, like, you know, between classes like you do.
Sure.
On the inside of the locker door. On the inside of the locker door, it said the words hip hop.
That was like their club right there. That they opened the locker and this like boombox was inside the locker. And then on the inside of the locker door, like in Sharpie, it was like, hip hop, like this is that's the spot.
I don't like when they spell it out that much.
Dude, every high school movie has at least that amount of spelled outness for the freaking hip hop dancing.
Yeah.
Okay, between classes, we got some people who are going to do some hip hop dances.
That's because hip hop was popular in the 90s. And now what we would not consider hip hop is super popular.
I mean, I know we went to Catholic school, but like we always loved hip hop, but at no point in between classes, did anyone ever say, like, quick hip-hop dance break? Should we do it?
Yeah.
Maybe it's just because our school was full of white people, but I don't. That's not part of my like high school experience.
No, it definitely wasn't. We didn't have time to do that. Like even now, like if they stopped to do a hip hop dance outside of a locker that says hip hop, they'd be late for class.
They'd be late for class. Yeah, and what if you got to take a leak? You got to go get some books out of your locker.
Like, no, they don't give them lockers anymore. That's where they keep the drugs. I wish I was joking.
Problem solved.
Another thing I wrote down is in that when they went to the museum and Brendan Fraser is starting to figure it out. Link's starting to figure it out.
Right.
And he's looking through the window at the actual, like, I don't know, paleontologists, archaeologists, anthropologists, whoever they are.
Museum person.
Yeah, they're like dusting off like bones and stuff. They're holding them perfect for the camera, but nobody would dust them off like that. And I didn't like that. They could have just put the camera in a different spot. Like, that was bothering me.
Yep.
And then the bar. She was dancing on the bar. He was like...
He was like swinging from something?
He was swinging from the ceiling. Freaking Pauly Shore was like...
He's taking shots of tequila?
Yeah, with... Where's the worm? All I could think of, again, was Trojan War. It was like... Freaking... Pepper cherries on, man. Nah, silver dollars, Holmes.
Silver dollars, Holmes.
Like, that whole bit. Like, I just... I didn't like the bar scene that much.
I didn't either. I thought it was just so... It was the most stereotypical portrayal of Mexicans for at least 5 years on either side of this movie. Maybe until the Trojan War.
Yeah, I didn't... I didn't like it.
I didn't like that Rudy got mad because Katie from PCU decided she liked Brendan Fraser and that was who he liked. And so he drove Brendan Fraser into the woods and then tried to, like, shoo him away like Harry and the Hendersons. Like,
I thought Harry... Dude, I wrote down Harry and the Hendersons.
Yeah, I was like, what the hell? Dude, this guy knows no one except you. And because your chick that you're obsessed with that doesn't care about you thinks he's cute, you're going to freaking go release him into the wilderness? That's bullshit.
Yeah, that was messed up. I also wrote down Harry and the Hendersons. It's so weird. When's that movie come out? Are we going to get to do that or it's already passed?
I think so. No, it's got to be in the early 90s. It's got to be.
I wrote down Harry and the Hendersons. That's so weird.
Dude, that's exactly what it was. Oh, 1987. Shit, we missed it by a lot.
Damn. We'll hit it on the BC tour.
Yeah, we'll hit it on the BC tour. And then I also had that, like, on the kind of related note, I didn't like that at the end of the movie, Rudy got to make out with Katie from PCU because the whole movie he was freaking creepy and he was stalkerish, and then somehow he got the girl. I hated that.
He used his one phone call when he was in jail to call her and ask her to prom.
Yeah, dude, and then, like, laid heavy pressure when she was like, nah, I don't think so. And he's like, but I'm in jail. It's my only phone call. It's like, dude, she's not into you. Stop being creepy.
And also, who bailed him out? I guess his parents?
I feel like maybe she sent Pauly Shore to go get him after he called them.
Yeah. Do you have to pay? Dude, he was looking for it in his pockets for a coin, and Brendan Fraser had to give him a coin. Do you have to pay for your own one phone call?
I don't know. I don't think so.
I wouldn't think so either.
I think you had to, like, maybe put the coin in to make the phone work, because after he made the call, Brendan Fraser, like, grabbed the coin out of the return.
Yeah, I can remember. I remember that being a thing because I always wanted to just pull the little return and get the coin back, but that never works.
Yeah. I didn't have any other worst. I mean, this movie's, like, super silly, but it's supposed to be.
Did you have some worst effects?
Not really. I mean, you know, the stunt driving is obviously really, it's really apparent that that's not happening.
They were really driving the car. That just really wasn't Brendan Fraser. Like,
Well, it wasn't Brendan Fraser, but also the car was, like, lifted up on some stuff.
Was it? Are you sure?
You don't just take a normal car and, like, yank the wheel and put it up on a 45-degree angle and then drive it down the street. Like, if you want to do that with a stunt car, I think you have to put, like, special tires on and probably, like, mess with the suspension a lot and, like, do a bunch of stuff.
Yeah, but I'm saying, like, there was no, like, wires or anything. The car was up on two wheels, right?
No, I don't think there were any wires. I just think they put a bunch of cinder blocks on one side of the car and, like, changed the tires out and, right, like, did a bunch of that stuff.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. They, like, played it and he was driving directly into the sun and the camera was directly in the front and it was definitely an overweight white guy that wasn't Brendan Fraser driving that car.
Yeah, and then when he was frozen in ice, the ice looked pretty plasticky to me, but yeah, I don't care. And then when the ice finally melted, it just looked like Brendan Fraser was laying with a bunch of sonic ice all over his chest.
Yeah,
like it just broke up into perfect cubes.
When I read about the ones that were on the sawhorse that cracked, like those big pieces, that's the one that cost so much money. And they said, like, it broke, and the actual dummy on the inside broke in half with it. And Brendan Fraser was, like, standing off camera, and he was like, "Ouch, that looks like it hurt." I hope I don't have to do that. And they're like, now what do? We don't even have any of the big chunks left that like hit the ground and shattered. They're like, just get some ice out of the machine and throw it on top. They always talk about how they regret that every time they see it.
Yeah, because we spent all our money on this one ice scene, and then we had to just go to Sonic for the remainder of the ice scene, just toss that on top of Brendan Fraser.
Yeah.
But again, like I don't care. If I was making this movie, even if I had the ability to CGI that, I would just go get some ice out of the machine. Who gives a shit?
Yeah, just dump it on top of it.
Pauly Shore's dialogue makes no sense. Just use the ice.
Doesn't matter. Old tech alert, did you have anything there?
The only one I really had was the MTV, him watching the like giant console TV and like channel surfing.
I wrote down that Pauly Shore had a Walkman, and it was the same one we talked about before. And there was an old school Doritos bag that had the yellow and orange squares around the word Doritos.
Yeah, like white on top and then like different color below that, yellow or whatever.
Yeah. And then Pauly Shore says milk does a body good.
Yeah.
So he mentions the ad that we talked about in the other episode.
Sean Whaley from Batman.
Yeah.
Batman Begins to Return Forever.
Yes. So milk does a body good. Pass it on.
Nice.
Political incorrectness. I had one.
Yeah, probably the same one. The Michael DeLuise, the bully, used a gay slur towards Brendan Fraser.
Yeah, he called him the F word.
And I don't even remember why he was upset at what Brendan Fraser was doing in the movie. I don't even remember, like, when it happened, I was like, that seems like an overreaction, even for the bully.
Back then, though, people used to say that all the time.
No, I know, but it was clearly meant to be, like, a big insult.
And right.
At the moment, I was like, he didn't even do anything.
Right.
But yeah, I had that one.
Yeah, cool. All right, what you got?
Hi, I'm Troy McClure. You may remember me from such films as Smoke Yourself Thin and Get Confident, Stupid.
We already talked about one of the cameos. One of the gang members, Michael DeLuise's buddies, who I don't think he even has a line in this movie, is Sue from Swingers, Patrick Van Horn.
Boy named Sue.
Didn't you see Boys in the Hood? Now one of us is going to get shot.
Bash his face in, man. Just get hitting it.
Sue, no one's going to steal your fucking gay car.
In case somebody steps to you, Snoop Dogg, Jesus.
Like House of Pain's going to do anything. I think Swingers is coming up sooner than I thought. I think it's 1996.
Wow, really?
Yeah, I'm very excited about that.
I had the teacher who could go for some flapjacks.
Yeah.
Just put that anywhere, pal. And then Dave's dad was the guy from License to Drive.
Dave's dad, his name's Richard Mazur.
Yeah.
Not only is he the dad from License to Drive, he's also the dad from My Girl.
My Girl. Was it two?
My Girl and My Girl Too.
Yeah.
Vaden Saltonfuss is dad.
Yes. Yeah.
And he's also Michael Keaton's boss in Multiplicity.
Yes. Can't wait for that one.
I know. Same. Yeah. So he's been in a bunch of stuff. And the only other one that I had was Rose McGowan.
Rose McGowan. I saw her. I have two of them that you might know and you might not. And when they walk into Blades, the roller rink that they go to. I mean, the ice rink that they go to. The guy slides his skateboard out in front of him and trips him when he's walking in. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
One of those guys is the kid from Event Horizon, the one that gets the one that gets like pushed out into space and starts in the movie, and I don't know his name in that. And there was another really big one that you missed. Do you remember the kid who wanted him to be on the chess team?
Wait, the computer club?
The computer club, and he wanted the chess team at the end, or the chess, something about chess in the end. And he was also given announcing the prom king and queen.
Yeah.
That short Asian fella is Short Round from
Indiana Jones, Temple of Doom.
And from Goonies, yeah.
Dude, I totally missed that. I thought he looked kind of familiar, but I did not put that together.
Yeah, he is definitely from that.
And the only other one that I had was Eric Avari, who is Raji, one of the convenience store clerks.
Yeah.
He's been in a ton of stuff. He's in Stargate, Independence Day, Mummy, Mr. Deeds, Daredevil.
I was going to say, I recognized him from Mummy, but I don't know if that was because Brendan Fraser and him were both on screen at the same time and it brought it back. But I recognized him.
Cool. Yeah, and Rose McGowan had like, you know, one line, but she was in the high school scenes. She was one of the little high school girls in this movie.
Dude, wasn't one of the girls that's the high school, the friend of Katie from PCU, wasn't she somebody? Robin Tunney?
Robin Tunney is, I know who that is.
She looks familiar. Empire Records, that's what it is.
Yeah, Empire Records.
I remembered seeing her, but I never knew who she was, and I just looked her up while we were talking. Sweet.
Yeah, dude, there's a ton of people in this movie. Like 12 memorable actors in this movie.
That's what makes it so good.
Highly enjoyable, really fast 90 minutes.
I liked it. That's my favorite part is the 90 minutes.
That's definitely my favorite part, because the 90 minutes is like front to back, including 6 minutes of credits.
Right.
Like, you're really an hour 20 here by the time you take out the intro and the outro.
Yeah.
All right. Five questions. Is it okay for kids?
Yeah. I was going to say absolutely. I would give it. My 9-year-old could have watched it with me. He didn't.
Nice.
But he could have. So yeah, I'd say kids are okay.
Would this movie get made if it were pitched now? I think so. Yeah. I think this movie is due a reboot. It's this version is fun, but it's not like so iconic that if I saw they're rebooting it, I'd be angry. I'd be like, oh, that's cool. I wonder who's going to do that.
So you still call it Encino Man? It's still set in California? Like, what do you...
I mean, set it wherever. Call it whatever. Encino Man is a perfectly fine title.
Yeah.
When they released this overseas, by the way, they called it California Man, because nobody overseas knows where Encino is.
Well, when I typed in Encino Man, I always go on Reddit and type in the name of the movie and see if I can find some really cool stuff.
Nice.
And when you type in Encino Man, it's like, Encino Man shows his junk on a bus and gets arrested. Then the next one's like, Encino Man kills his mother after she said he can no longer have Mountain Dew or whatever it was. There was a whole bunch of those. Yeah, dude, if you think it could be remade, that's great. I don't see that happening, but maybe I'm stuck on the Pauly Shore. Like, what would the Pauly Shore character say now?
I don't know. Just regular shit? Whatever dialogue they wrote that he didn't say, they could probably use the same script because none of his lines made it on air. He just made up all his own stuff.
So I could have my students write a whole bunch of stuff, and it would sound like Pauly Shore to you, and it's stuff that the kids say now. Like, look, I'm keeping it $1.50, okay? I'm just trying to keep it $1.50.
Yeah, just out here trying to secure the bag.
Yeah, you're freaking so extra.
Yeah, dude, just full send.
Just wheezing the juice. That's so mid.
I can't believe Rudy out there simping for that chick.
It's so sus.
Cool. So we'll write this. We'll write the sequel. We got the lingo down.
Can we have him read it like I read Pauly Shore's line too? Just completely straight.
Yeah, I think you could remake this easily. I think it would be a fun movie that wouldn't cost a lot of money to make. I don't know why, but they remake shit all the time, so who knows?
I'm with you. I hope they remake it so we can talk about it.
Movie or TV show? I don't know. It seems like a movie.
Yeah, it's a movie.
This is the heart of who plays the lead if we remake it. I couldn't figure that part out. I don't know. I don't like, there's no like young up and coming MTV VJ Pauly Shore that you want to make this a vehicle for.
Correct.
Like, I just don't know. There's no such thing, right? There's no MTV. There's no VJs. There's no, like, you'd have to go like, who's the like Instagram or TikTok person,
right,
that you want to launch a film career for? And I don't know who those people are, because I hate that.
Yeah, I don't know any of those people either. When I got down to that thing on the notes where it says who plays the lead, I just put Brendan Fraser again because I like him.
I love Brendan Fraser. He could be the teacher.
He could.
I don't even know where to start the recast. Like, neither. Stick one of the kids from Stranger Things as the Rudy part. Find some up and coming young edgy comedian to be the Pauly Shore guy.
Yeah.
Like, for Brendan Fraser, I just said like Ryan Reynolds, because he loves to have his shirt off.
Yeah.
And he's super lanky and like he could be really physical. He's Brendan Fraser's age, but I don't know who else to put there.
Right.
Like, is there some NBA player who wants to make a move in the offseason? Like, is Kyrie Irving want to do that? I don't know who to do, like, where to.
I don't want Kyrie Irving.
Like, I don't want that either, but I just don't know who to put there.
Yeah, I'm with you. I don't know. I don't know the answer.
Dude, the longer the podcast goes on, the harder we're going to have to get rid of this question, because we're just going to get older and we're going to know even less about 25-year-old actors.
Yeah, but we don't always do movies with 25-year-olds in it. So
we don't.
I'm hoping we can keep this one because I like this one.
I do too, and it's fun to think about. All right, last question. Can you watch and enjoy this movie in 2022?
I did, yeah.
Yeah, it's fine. Yeah. It's good.
Yeah, go so quick. It's good. Yeah.
Yeah.
Butternuts. Butter stuff.
90 minutes. Right through. All right, so it looks like it's actually not on Disney Plus. So this one is for rent, $2.99, $3.99. You can spend money on it.
It wouldn't be bad to spend money on it. It'd be worth it.
If you want to go back to 1992 and hear Pauly Shore say a bunch of weird stuff and see Brendan Fraser's first movie role, it's totally worth $2 or $3.
Agreed.
And it is completely enjoyable. Thanks for listening. Please feel free to rate and review and join us on Discord if you have some recasting ideas, because we're completely clueless on this one.
Somebody will know some younger people.
Somebody's got to know. I mean, you can only know more than us on this one.
Right.
Next episode is Patriot Games. Harrison Ford.
Hooray.
Tom Clancy.
Jack Ryan.
Yeah, Jack Ryan. I don't remember that movie all that well, so that'll be fun.
Yeah, I kind of remember it, but not that much. So yeah, I'm with it. Excited to do it. The man, the freaking cheese is old and moldy.
queso es viejo y podrido.
And cut.
Thanks for listening to Movie Life Crisis. Please subscribe, rate, and review. And remember, don't drive angry.